everyone. Let's all stand. Number 26 in your hymn book. Great is thy faithfulness. Let's sing about our faithful God on that first verse. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my
thank you for being here, and we're so grateful for God's goodness and His mercies and His blessings on us, and we want to go to Him tonight in prayer. As we pray, I want you to be praying for Brother Jerry Scalf. They just right before service, they let us know that they actually took him in for surgery. You know, he's been in the hospital, and he's got blood clots that they're worried about, and but they're going to go in surgically and do some things about them, and so they're concerned there. So I told them we would sure be praying, so they'll be doing that probably during church. So we'll pray for him, and then we'll pray for our service as well. We'll introduce you to some special guests here in just a moment. I know you'll be blessed by them, but let's go to the Lord in prayer. Would you pray with me? Father, we're grateful for the chance to be in your house. We do pray for Brother Jerry Scalf right now that you'd bless him, dear Lord, and I pray that you would just have your will and your way. You would strengthen him. You would protect him through this surgery. May it get all that accomplished that it needs to, and just pray that you'd bless him. And then, dear Lord, I pray that you would touch this service. I thank you for the group that you brought our way. I pray that you'd use them and to be a blessing to our hearts. I pray that we could be a blessing to them as well. But, dear Lord, I just pray that you meet with us. Lord, it's just a wonderful thing as Christians to gather together never knowing when will be our last time, dear Lord. We'll know one of these days we'll all gather together in heaven, but now we get a little bit of heaven to go to heaven with, and so I thank you for this time to be here tonight. Bless it, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, there's a wonderful place to train for the ministry and train for what God has for a young person's life. And it's not very far from here, about an hour and a half or so in Powell, Tennessee, right outside of Knoxville. And back in 1991, Crown College was started at the Temple Baptist Church. And Dr. Clarence Sexton has been its founder and president now for all of these years. And it's a wonderful place. And we're thanking the Lord that's so close, a beautiful spot. Of course, our nation, like just where we are, but also one that trains folks for the ministry, and they've got hundreds of graduates out just serving the Lord. And so with that in mind, there's a group from Crown College, and they're going to come and sing for us, be a blessing to us. Their table is out in the back. If you'd like to get more information after the service, they'll be out there, and you're welcome to talk to one of them. You've got somebody that's interested in going to train for the ministry. You couldn't go to a better place. It's a wonderful, wonderful spot to be there, and I know you'll hear more about it. Thank you, guys.
And we're really the central trio. So we've been in the Midwest. We were even in Canada for 2 weeks. So it's a blessing to be in the South once again. And no, the Lord has been very good. He's kept us safe. He's given us many gospel opportunities. I mean, all over the place. Just about everywhere we've been able to give the gospel to someone. And he's been very good. And as Pastor Herdman said, there's information at the back table about all the different areas of study. Ministry, education, science and healthcare, trades and technology. I'd like to say this, you know, there are extension campuses in Montana, also in the UK, and I believe you all know about the campus in the United Kingdom in England. I spent a semester there actually with Pastor and Mrs. Mullins at Beaches Road. And I'd just like to say thank you to you all because that semester really changed my life. And I hope you know they could not do what they do without you all and the influence you've had in their lives. And so God's been very good, and the guys will introduce themselves now, and I'm going to make my way to the piano.
Hi, my name is Tyler Matthews. I'm from Hattiesburg, Mississippi, and I will be a junior this coming fall at Crown College studying pastoral ministries.
My name is Jonathan Shaw. I'm from DeLand, Florida. I'm going into my sophomore year at Crown College, and I'm studying youth ministries.
Hi, my name is Colton Davis. I'm from Alberta, Canada. I'll be a senior this year at the Crown College studying pastoral and ministries.
Are you weary from the battle you're fighting? Does it seem like the storm just won't break? Is there a mountain in front of you that doubt says will never move? And you wonder, will God make a way?
Tell me a time he's not been faithful. Tell me a morning his mercies were new. Tell me a moment he wasn't able to carry you through. Tell me a day he was less than almighty, when he could not roll back the tide. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find there was never a time.
So be strong in the Lord and remember to take hold of faith and stand firm. Oh, you can be confident, the Lord keeps his promises. If you doubt it, just read through his word.
Tell me a time he's not been faithful. Tell me a morning his mercies were new. Tell me a moment he wasn't able to carry you through. Tell me a day he was less than almighty, when he could not roll back the tide. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find there was never a time. Oh, he can work miracles, do the impossible. If you don't believe it, just go on and try.
tell me a time he's not been faithful. Tell me a morning his mercies were new. Tell me a moment he wasn't able to carry you through. Tell me a day he was less than almighty, when he could not roll back the tide. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find there was never a time. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find there was never a time. Never a time.
The angry crowd cried out to crucify. They nailed him to a rugged cross and left him there to die. They gambled for the royal robe he wore, not knowing they had crucified my Lord. He bore the sin and shame of all mankind, and as he hung there dying, I was on his mind. His sacrifice and love some don't appreciate, but I would like to speak and set the record straight.
That's my God and I love him. That's my Jesus, he died for me. For all the world to hear, I'll say it loud and clear. That's my God, that's my God.
Some say he's nothing more than fairy tale. He's just a myth or legend. His presence is not real. His word is not correct politically. They curse and mock his name defiantly. Oh, but time has never changed the changeless one. Their lies cannot disprove the existence of God's Son. Though some may be content to just sit by,
I for one must stand and testify. That's my God and I love him. That's my Jesus, he died for me. For all the world to hear, I'll say it loud and clear. That's my God, that's my God. That's my God and I love him. That's my Jesus, he died for me. For all the world to hear, I'll say it loud and clear. That's my God, that's my God. That's my God, that's my God.
When America was founded, she was strong and pure and good. And her leaders on their knees were not ashamed to call on God. But our nation in her pride has turned her back upon the right. And a cloud of evil threatens to turn glory into night. Strong wickedness has crept in like a cold and bloody thief. Those who know the Lord and do his word stand by in disbelief. For the love of God and country, we must not cease for a day. For the future of our children, we must lift our hearts and pray.
Turn the tide, Lord, turn the tide. Open wide the floodgates of your power. Stem the flood of wickedness. Restore, revive, and bless. Turn the tide.
God's enemy is hard at work, undermining everywhere. Breaking down foundations, twisting laws and setting snares. He would take away our freedom and replace it with despair. And he laughs at those opposing him as if they were not there. But God's children cannot sit by, we must stand up and defend. For the battle is not over till our King declares the end. We must work and fight and meet him, not as those that beat the air. For the greatest weapon in our hands is strong and fervent prayer.
Turn the tide, Lord, turn the tide. Open wide the floodgates of your power. Stem the flood of wickedness. Restore, revive, and bless. Turn the tide.
Though the waves of immorality may beat upon the shore, and it seems that all ungodliness is knocking at our door,
we must never give up hope. We must not let them win the war. We must plead with him who has the power to cleanse and to restore. Restore!
Turn the tide, Lord, turn the tide. Open wide the floodgates of your power. Stem the flood of wickedness. Restore, revive, and bless. Turn the tide. Our prayer, Lord, turn the tide.
Man, what a blessing it is to be reminded of the truths that we all hold dear. And so thank you guys for singing those songs. We'll hear a few more from them in a little bit for the message, but just want to let you know or remind you about some announcements, some things that are coming up in the services soon. For all those who are newer to the church, we would invite you to a newcomers fellowship that's going to take place next Sunday after the 11 o'clock service. And so if that's you, or maybe you know somebody that is newer, but they aren't here right now, and you want to reach out to them, make sure that they know about it. We'd love to have them. We'll love to fellowship around with them, get to know them a little bit better. And if you think back to the time that you were newer to the church, you were glad when you had those opportunities to get to know people a little bit more. And so I want to invite those who are newer and make sure that they know about that. There's a sign-up table in the lobby. And then ladies, there's a ladies game night on July the 29th, and there is a sign-up on the table as you go out the main doors as well. So you could sign up for that. And then also I think there's a sign-up for a book for the ladies Bible study that's beginning in August as well. And so you can check for some information on that on the table as you leave. And then if you're in the Oasis group, or when I announce the Oasis group and you're not even sure what that is, then maybe see Brother Dan afterwards about that. But there is a picnic on the 6th this Thursday, drop-in picnic from 10 to 4 at the Eastman Picnic Shelter. And it'll be a wonderful time of fellowship with the group. And if you are able to come to that, I know that there's a lot of good things planned. And so you can enjoy that as it comes up here in just a few days. Well, we had a wonderful week this last week. I want to thank everybody for praying for Junior Day Camp. Just such a highlight of the summer for so many. And I want to thank you for your support. Thank you for your prayers. And we took some videos and pictures and things along the way throughout the week. And so we're going to watch a video here in just a moment. And but one of the things we did this year, we gave out some verse sheets the kids worked on throughout the week, and just thought it'd be a great thing for you to know that the kids that were there this week said, memorized and said to some of the workers and leaders, 350 verses collectively as a group. So it was a wonderful week, and so thank the Lord for them hiding God's word in their hearts and your prayers for that. So we'll watch the video at this time.
We're not going to do the chicken dance like they were doing, but 430, sing this chorus with me, will you?
The windows of heaven are open, the blessings are falling to God. There's joy in my heart, this Jesus made everything right. Why can't I go back to God? He gave me a robe of pure white.
Yeah.
As a blind man was sitting there by the way, he cried to Jesus for mercy that day. And Jesus commanded and gave him his sight. And oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Jesus passed by my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, but then Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life since Jesus passed by. Just like that blind man, I wandered along. In darkness of sin, I was always alone. Then one day I met him, and he made things right. And oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Jesus passed by my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, but then Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life since Jesus passed by. Jesus passed by my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, but then Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life since Jesus passed by. And oh, what a change in my life since Jesus passed by.
Yes, amen.
see our Savior hung between two thieves. Hear the soldiers mock His name. See His followers as they cry in disbelief. This could not be the reason why He came. See them realize His life is through, and feel the love burn from His eyes. Behold the temple veil as it is torn in two, and hear the one on Calvary as He cries. Paid in full, I've done the work I came to do. Paid in full, I paid love's final price for you. When all hell tries to tell you that you'll never win, just remember that the debt for your sin is paid in full.
See His children torn between two ways. Some still choose to mock His name. See His followers now as they can boldly say,
we are the reason why He came. See the ones who trust themselves alone to do what only Christ can do. Through Jesus' blood alone we may approach the Father's throne and hear the words that He still calls to you. He calls to you. Paid in full, I've done the work I came to do. Paid in full, I paid love's final price for you. When all hell tries to tell you that you'll never win, just remember that the debt for your sin is paid in full. Paid in full. Paid in full.
Amen. Thank you, men, for singing. Thank you for that. And appreciate the good message in song, and we're glad that they've come our way. They've got a busy week coming up on them. They've got a youth conference there that starts tomorrow, I believe, and so they've got a lot ahead of them, but I'm so thankful that they were able to come with us and be here tonight. Well, we're looking into the book of Galatians again, chapter number 6. We're going to look at verses 1 through 5 tonight, and we'll take another section of Scripture as we preach through this book. Galatians chapter 6, verse number 1. We'll look at that and then get right into the message tonight. I do appreciate your prayers for me this week. I'll be heading to Arkansas. I'm going to preach at a camp. It's the same one I've been at last year and the year before. Each year, usually they have me come back. And so I appreciate your prayers. Brother Kyle will be preaching for us here this Wednesday night. And I want you to come and hear him and hear what God has put on his heart on that Wednesday. I believe the young people will meet downstairs and just for a check-in rally time. But then they'll come up this way sometime there in the pre-service. So the teens will be joining the service partway through. And so I know it'll be a great evening, but appreciate your prayers. And I'm hoping to sweat off some weight. They said last week the feels like temperature was 114 where I'm going. And so it's if I come back looking slim and slender, you'll know I'm just dehydrated. Hydrated and I sweat it all out. So, but you pray for me, and we trust to be a blessing to a lot of young people down there, and they have a great program. And this camp is a ministry of the church. We were our home church in Murfreesboro, and so we got associated with it years ago. Brother John Bishop started it back in the 70s. Brother John's from up here in Abingdon area, Bristol, somewhere up that way. And so he started back in the 70s, and it's been going strong ever since. So I'll have the privilege of preaching this week. Appreciate you praying. Galatians chapter 6, we're looking at verse number 1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, so fulfill the law of Christ. For if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself. But let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. For every man shall bear his own burden. And so we'll look at the contrast there where it says in verse number 2 to bear one another's burdens. And then in verse number 5 it tells us to bear your own burden and trust it's all a blessing to you. But we come to this wonderful passage of Scripture, and it's really a very favorite part of this passage of mine. We're right on the heels of the fruit of the Spirit we learned about last time. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, all of those. And now it's as if God is giving an illustration for that meekness, as it's listed here in the spirit of meekness. Well, that's one of the fruit up there in verse number 23, and it's as if God's just saying, in case you're wondering what I was talking about, let me explain it a little farther for you. And or as we used to say back home, explain that to me. And so we forgot the explain, but just explain that to me. And let's pray and ask the Lord's blessing. Father, be with us now in these moments. I pray that you'd let us have a wonderful time in your word. I pray, dear Lord, that we would live differently after we get done with church tonight than we did before we came and the word affected us. Please bless us in that way, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I love this verse, and I love in verse number 1, brethren, if a man be taken, overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, because it flies right in the face of all of us that want to be high and mighty and think like we're something. And God says, if you want to be so spiritual, you want to think you're such something, then ye which are spiritual, then you've got some job to do. If a man be overtaken in a fault, you folks that think we're so high and mighty, we're so walking with the Lord, we're so great at our relationship, our fellowship with Christ, then I tell you what, do. Why don't we restore such in one? But I know the same people that you may know, different folks, but same position, that some people, they act as if they've got everything figured out in their life, but they're the last one to reach down and help anybody when things go wrong in their life. And so the Scripture certainly combats that and tells them what they're supposed to do. It seems like we've gone way overboard, many of our churches, for in contending for the faith. And I believe you should contend. That's what the Scripture says. But sometimes we've gone so far in our contending for the faith, and instead what we are is we're just hateful and we're vindictive and contentious, as we call it. I'm standing for the faith, but really what we're doing is we're the one that's holding the bar or holding the gate to say, you can't come in here. Listen, my friend, I'd rather let somebody do too much and maybe not be quite ready than I would to be the spiritual gatekeeper to say, no, you haven't proved yourself enough. We'll get into that in just a little bit. But I want you to look in this first verse who's responsible for restoring that person who's fallen. Here's the faulty argument that some of us make. Whenever that person straightens up and they come and apologize to me, then I'll put them back up to where they need to be. But the Scripture actually puts the weight on you and I, if you're spiritual, that is, and not on the person that took a tumble. If a man be overtaken in the fault, ye which are spiritual. So the Bible says that the person in the relationship that is walking with the Lord has a whole lot more responsibility than the person that's off in something that they shouldn't be. And it's a good thing, because if they're off in doing something they shouldn't be, they're probably not looking too much to get right with the Lord. So I want you to just break a couple things down. Fault, the Bible says. That literally means just a falling aside or a mishap. Might be a small sin or an awful blunder, I don't know. But the Scripture just says if a man be overtaken in that fault. Now, I realize that the person that's overtaken, they have to want to get some reconciliation. I realize, because you say, well, I can't help somebody until they want to help themselves. And I believe that's a right concept to engage in. But I'm not speaking of that person that is just so far out and they don't want any help. I'm talking about those people that got caught up in something and they're waiting for a Christian brother or a Christian sister to help them up. May I add, just like somebody helped you up. Far as I know, nobody in here has been walking the straight and narrow ever since they got saved. You've walked good for a while, and then you tripped up on something, whether that was some problem, some standard that you were having trouble with, some decision you made, but then you fell back on. I believe that everybody in this room, if you're saved, you've had times in your life when you took a tumble, and I could say this for myself, thank God that somebody was there to help me get back up to where I should be. And so we see this evening, and we see this fault, that falling aside or that mishap that somebody does. But I want you to see not only the fault of somebody else, but then the spirit in which we're supposed to help them up in meekness. The definition is just literally appropriately humble, submissive to the divine will in the spirit of meekness. A lot of times we'll talk about Moses being the meekest man on the earth. And meekness is not being defeated. Meekness is just realizing who you are and who God is. You're appropriately humble. What does the Bible say in 1 Corinthians chapter 10? Let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. And I believe that there are some folks that need apologized to by some of us that have just been so proud of our own walk, proud of our own position, and we've been too proud to put a hand out to somebody to help them up. I know what we're going to say before I even say it. Well, I can't do that because what they did was wrong. Yes. And well, somebody might think I'm wrong if I help them out. You know what somebody's going to think about you if you help somebody out who's not really ready to be helped? They're going to think you were doing it in a kind way in Jesus' name. We sometimes worry too much about our reputation, thinking, well, what if I'd do that? What if I'd help them out? And then they fall right back down. I believe what people would say is, well, they did all they could and they helped them out. You know that's what the Lord did. The Lord was helping folks. He was always looking for sinners, never to condone their sin, never to get down there with them, but to always be ready to help them. And of course, He could heal them. We can't do that, but we can show them the one that can help them. So I want you to look at this in verse number 1. I see our command to lift the fallen. Ye which are spiritual, restore such an one. We worry so much about whether somebody's sincere or not that we won't reinstate anybody. Somebody in the church, somebody in your family, somebody in a group that you belong to, you're trying to figure out, well, are they really, really, really repentant about that? Are they sincere? And so we don't reinstate anybody because we don't want to be duped. We don't want to be marked as that person who fell for that sob story that they gave. I believe that as a church right here where we sit and stand, we ought to have a high standard of who serves and who does this. They ought not to be doing all the things the world does. And we've got big lists, you know all that. But I think that sometimes we want a person to prove themselves so long that we never let them back in the service. Is anybody in here not going to do anything wrong between now till the time Jesus comes pick you up? I think the answer is no, unless he comes really quick. Peter, the Bible says, was naked to whatever degree that was when Jesus came back there. He was on that boat. We know that David was involved in adultery, the man after God's own heart. Paul wouldn't give John Mark the benefit of the doubt after he turned back on him. I'm saying that some of God's choicest people have gotten to a place where they weren't having their best day. I know that we should be careful, and we certainly have to do our due diligence when we put somebody in a position. Maybe a church is calling a pastor, a church is hiring an assistant pastor, a church is doing this, that, the other. I understand we have to be careful about all of that, but let's just get down, as one old preacher said, where the rubber meets the road. Can we understand, or can you identify with me and realize that the Apostle Paul, the great missionary, the Apostle Paul, the great preacher, the Apostle Paul used of God to write much of the New Testament, can you agree with me that the Apostle Paul wouldn't be chosen by most pulpit committees to pastor an independent fundamental Baptist church? Jail time. If you had a candidate for a church and you were the pulpit committee for Victory Baptist Church in somewhere USA, and you said, we've got this guy, I believe he's a great fella. He's got some health problems. He's got some issues, got a little bit of a temper, and he's also had some jail time. That would not be the person that you put at the top of your candidate list. Not only him, but Peter wouldn't hire him as your outreach director because of the testimony it had. He's the one that was at bracken, and was cussing as he was talking to him about the Lord. John, he didn't have any college training. The College of Jesus, he went to that one, but he didn't go to any other ones. He didn't have any diplomas on his wall. And so most people, he never pastored a church. So in his early ministry there, most people would never say that he's the guy that we want. I'm just saying that ye which are spiritual, restore such an one. So we're commanded to lift the fallen. But I want you to look down at verse number 2. Not only are we supposed to lift the fallen, but the Bible says we're supposed to help carry the load, bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. Read a story about a lady that was on a crowded bus in another country, and she had some basket that was very heavy, and so she was just trying to put it on her lap, and the man that was sitting beside of her, he scooted over as best he could, enough to give her enough room, and he saw it was painful, it was heavy, And he told the lady, if you set it on the seat here or on the floor in front of you, the bus will carry you and the basket. Carry that load for you. And you know there's some people around your neighborhood and your family and this church, in our community, that are looking for somebody to carry the load for them. You never know what a blessing you might be to somebody if only you would say, can I help you with that? Amen. You say, well, they won't let me. The least you offered. You say, well, it's their fault that they're in that position anyways. Back to my first point, when we don't want to act like we're so higher, holier than thou and high and mighty, we're supposed to restore such an one, help carry the load. There are physical burdens, there's grief, and there's tensions, and there's insecurities, there's all of these other things. When was the last time that you helped somebody carry the load that they had? That's why I say about prayer. I think the best thing you can do for somebody is pray for them. The second best thing you can do is let them know that you're praying, because then they know that you're in the yoke with them. You are bearing that burden. You are helping them. And what you can also do past prayer is go find out the problem that they have, and you can help them bear that burden. Maybe it's making a meal. Maybe it's taking them out. Maybe it's helping them with this, that, or the other. I'm saying that we as a people are by and large too selfish, and that's why the scripture tells us to bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. Because if that phrase is true, which we know it is at the end of the verse, and so fulfill the law of Christ, what would be the opposite if we don't bear one another's burdens? Well, then we would not be fulfilling the law of Christ. I would love for all of us to get our blinders off and see the needs that people have, and us be the agent to meet those needs. I'm privileged to be the pastor of this great church. And I'm privileged in many ways, but one of them is this. Oftentimes people will ask me, Pastor, do you know about so-and-so, a need that they have? Or do you know of if they need, have a need of this? And just because of my position, they'll sometimes ask me in confidence, and they'll say, would you help me get some help to this person? And that thrills my heart. Because somebody's seeing a burden that they have the wherewithal to meet or to carry, and then they simply do it. I believe that God shows us lots of stuff. But I also believe that sometimes we're too busy, we're too preoccupied, sometimes we're too stubborn, but maybe we're just too awkward with how to ask if I can help you with that. And so the Bible says not only should we help carry the load, but we should also help carry the load. Now I want you to look on in verse number 3 and 4. For if a man think that he to be something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. That goes along with that bearing one another's burdens. Because we say it like this in West Virginia: don't get too big for your britches. Don't think that so this is never going to happen to you. A man that think he standeth, let him take heed lest he fall, as I mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And so just the moment you think, I'm not going to help them because nobody ever helps me, that is a great way to get yourself positioned where you're going to need your burden bared by somebody. And I certainly want to be in the position where I've helped somebody else. But we look at verse number 4, and we see here in verse 4 and 5 that there are thirdly some burdens that you've got to bear alone. Let every man prove his own work, and then he shall have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. For every man shall bear his own burdens. Now that person that says, see, there's contradictions in the Bible. It says in verse number 2 to bear your other's burdens. And now in this verse number 5, it says some of you got to bear alone. Well, there's very good reason for that, because as many burdens as you can bear for some brother or sister in Christ or some person on your street or in your church, wherever, as many burdens as you can bear for them, there are some that you're simply going to have to bear alone. This word for burden is a different word than the first one was in verse number 2. And this literally means a load to be borne. It's a word used when ladies deliver a baby, when they carry that weight and they carry that child in the womb. That's a burden that they've got to bear. And there's some burdens that you have to. Let me just give you a few thoughts about this. Sometimes you're going to have to suffer alone. As much as well-meaning people want to help you out, there's going to be times when you just have to suffer. Can I tell you, when you've got to suffer alone, you are not, my friend, if you're a Christian brother or sister, you actually aren't alone. because he promises he'll never leave us nor forsake us. You'll sometimes, though, have to, humanly speaking, suffer alone. Even if you've got a wonderful spouse that wants to be there with everything, you've got to suffer that alone sometimes. Not only do you have to suffer some things alone, but you've also got to face death alone. Will that way, we'll all go that way unless the rapture comes, and I hope he comes and gets us. I'm not afraid of death, but I just hate pain, and pain a lot of times is associated with death. And so I'm looking to go up in the rapture. You say, oh, good, a pastor's looking to go, then I want to go with him. I want you to go as well, but I was looking for it yesterday, and it didn't come either, so I could be wrong. It's coming one of these days. But death is something that you're going to have to go through alone. We'll have to go that way unless the rapture comes. An agnostic by the name of Thomas Hobbes said when it was his time to come to death, I'm taking a fearful leap in the dark. And then he cried, and I say this cautiously, oh God, it is lonely. So somebody that denied God for most of his existence, when he got to the point where he's going to cross over, even by his verbiage, admitted and cried out to God, not in salvation, but said, it's lonely. Now that's not what the Christian has to face. The Christian faces to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. But you oftentimes will have to go through that time alone. But not only that, the suffering and the death that you'll have to face eventually. But can I give you this third one? The judgment seat of Christ. The Bible says we must all appear before that judgment seat of Christ. We mentioned it just in a service recently. That's not for the unsaved, that's for the saved. Everybody's there is saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. They are not getting judged for their sins. They're getting judged for their service, and they're going to see what they did for the Lord Jesus Christ. And so some of these burdens you're just simply going to have to bear on your own. If every Christian bears every burden they can, there'll be still plenty to go around. How many of you live long enough to know that burdens are everywhere? And you don't have to say, I'm going to toughen that person up. I'm going to let them carry their own burden. You carry every burden you can. There'll still be enough for them to go around. I believe, really I do, that many of us Christians have missed the will of God in different areas of our lives because we didn't pick up a burden for somebody else. Now you say, what does that mean, Pastor? Well, that could just mean you've taken their burden and you're going to God in prayer regularly for that. You're bearing it in prayer. That also could mean that you're doing something physically for them around the house. I was blessed to hear that there's some men building a ramp for a good Christian brother so he can get in and out after he gets out of his hospital stay. That's bearing somebody's burden. There's people all the time that some of the great ladies that are right here sitting in front of me, you'll bring meals whenever we have a funeral, and so we'll feed them over here at the Family Life Center somewhere. And you don't get to hear that, and I wish you did. You don't get to hear the responses that those families give. Say, Pastor, this is so nice. We didn't have to think about any of this stuff. And you ladies make that happen. What are you doing when you do that? You're bearing one another's burdens. You're taking something that they could do. Sure, they could. But you're allowing yourself to be a blessing to them by bearing one another's burdens. There's other things that we do, and you realize that it's a great joy to lift the fallen, to help carry the load. And I believe that many of us have missed the will of God in small little areas because we didn't have the spiritual gumption, so to speak, just to bear the burden of somebody. Whether that was selfish, I've got enough on my own plate. Can I tell you some of the ways that I've helped myself in problems that I've had is by looking at somebody else's problem and helping them out of the problem, and somehow when I came back to mine, it didn't look quite so bad? You say, what kind of math is that? I don't know, but I find it works. Amen. And I believe we missed the mark a lot of times when we simply didn't just bear one another's burdens. A very practical lesson tonight. And I trust that we've got a church full of people. I know we do. I already watch you. So I'm not telling you to do something you don't already do. But I'm asking us to do a heap more of it. Be on the lookout when you could be a blessing to somebody. And I believe you'll find, like many people I've heard tell me already, that you'll find that you went trying to be a blessing, but instead you were a blessed person because of it. And why are we doing all this? because Jesus made a difference in your life? Since Jesus passed by in your life, then we are a different person. I'm just trying to bear people's burdens all along the way. I'm going to ask the young men to come back and sing, Since Jesus Passed By. And we'll just, the other instrumentalists, will just forego that, but let them come back and sing both of those last songs, I guess, Since Jesus Passed By, and then Paid in Full. And I want you to think about this in your life. If God's been so good, and He has, to bless you, to save you, He passed by this way, your way, wouldn't we want to be a great representative of Him every chance we get and bear one another's burdens? Would you sing for us, guys, both songs?
As a blind man was sitting there by the way, he cried to Jesus for mercy that day. And Jesus commanded and gave him his sight. And oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by.
Jesus passed by my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, but then Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life since Jesus passed by.
Just like that blind man, I wandered along. In darkness of sin, I was always alone.
Then one day I met him, and he made things right. And oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Jesus passed by my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, but then Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life since Jesus passed by. Jesus passed by my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, but then Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life since Jesus passed by. And oh, what a change in my life since Jesus passed by.
Our Savior hung between two thieves. Hear the soldiers mock His name. See His followers as they cry in disbelief. This could not be the reason why He came.
See them realize His life is through, and feel the love burn from His eyes.
Behold the temple veil as it is torn in two, and hear the one on Calvary as he cries. Paid in full, I've done the work I came to do. Paid in full,
I paid love's final price for you. When all hell tries to tell you that you'll never win, just remember that the debt for your sin is paid in full.
See his children torn between two ways. Some still choose to mock his name. See his followers now as they can boldly say,
we are the reason why he came. See the ones who trust themselves alone to do what only Christ can do. Through Jesus' blood alone, we may approach the Father's throne and hear the words that he still calls to you. He calls to you, paid in full. I've done the work I came to do, paid in full. I paid love's final price for you. When all hell tries to tell you that you'll never win, just remember that the debt for your sin is paid in full. Paid in full. Paid in full.
Amen. Brother Danny, would you mind just playing something over there as an invitation song? If you're able to, would you stand together with us? With all that Christ has done for us, and then he tells us in these chapters to bear one another's burdens. And I'd love for us to go out like a great army looking for people who we can be a blessing to. You say, won't people take advantage of me? They probably will, but most of the time you'll learn it pretty quick. Well, won't I do things for them that they could have done for themselves? Certainly. But that still doesn't negate our responsibility, our command to bear one another's burdens. And I trust that you walk out of this room looking for folks to be a blessing to. If you're here tonight and you're not sure that you're on your way to heaven, I challenge you to make this the night that you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. He didn't come to give you a good life here. He didn't come to make you a better person. He didn't come to make you a better husband, to do great things in your life. He came to save your soul from your sins. All those other things are byproducts. He does make you a better husband. He does make you better these things. But that's not why he came. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. If you're here tonight, not sure that you're saved, would you slip out and come while our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, and we're just here in a time of prayer as he plays just a verse or two. Would you slip out? Brother Daniel's down here. He'd love to take a Bible and show you how you can be sure that you're saved on your way to heaven. Maybe there's some other spiritual need you have. You are saved. You know that. But you've never followed Christ in baptism. You've never taken a public stand to call, or to show, rather, that you're saved. You're called by the name of Christ, and you'd like to come and present yourself for baptism tonight. Would you do that? Maybe you'd like to make Buffalo Ridge Baptist Church your church home. Whatever it is, as he plays, would you slip out and come as he just plays another part of this verse? You do business with the Lord. So much. You may look this way. Well, it's been a joy to have the Crown group with us, the Midwest trio. Somehow we slipped into the Midwest. but we don't want to be there. We're glad to be in the South. So, but I'm going to ask them to slip on back to their table, if you don't mind. Brother Danny, I know his dad was the assistant pastor at the same church I was the assistant pastor at in Ripley, West Virginia. And so after I left, his dad, Brother Thomas Satterfield, who pastors a great church down in Georgia now, but his dad was on staff there at the same church, and so a wonderful family, and so we're so thankful for them coming to be our way. Just as a little report, this morning we're thanking the Lord that there were 125 in the 8:45 service and 490 in the 11 o'clock service, and so we're praising the Lord 6:15 in church this morning, and what a joy that is to hear about, and thank you for being part of all of it, and we're certainly thankful for what God's doing. Please be safe and careful if you're traveling. As I mentioned, please pray for me as I go to Arkansas, but many of you be traveling over the next couple of days. Please be safe and be blessed, and we're looking forward to, I'll look forward to the reports about Brother Kyle. I'll be preaching down there. And then please be praying for this Sunday to God to give us a wonderful, wonderful day again. And we'll look forward to it all. God bless you. Thank you for being here. You're dismissed.